All right, so we're going to talk about some cool stuff today. Tell us a little bit about who you are and what you do at Microsoft.
My name is Ratul Mahajan. I'm a researcher at Microsoft Research. I am in the Mobility and Networking Research Group there.
And you've got a project called the Lab of Things.
Oh, yeah, totally.
Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah. So I think we started working on this project about 3 or 4 years ago. I think some of us in Microsoft Research, we were looking at essentially just the state of technology in the home, starting with the observation that a lot of hardware devices that you associate with home technology were becoming really cheap and easy to install. So I'm kind of talking about things like cameras, motion sensors, locks, smoke sensors, thermostats. You could go out on the market today and buy each of these devices from anywhere between $30 and $100. So hardware was becoming really cheap, but at the same time, I think hardware is becoming cheaper and hardware was becoming easier to install. So it didn't require any kind of special wiring in the home. It'll work off of regular AA or dot cell batteries, or it'll work on just your normal stuff. No longer low voltage wiring and things like that were required for the hardware to work. And at the same time, I think wireless standards were also maturing. So Extranet and Instion got a bad reputation for being unreliable because they were first to market in 1970s, but newer standards like Z-Wave and Zigbee and BLE coming along, and they're getting a lot more reliable too. So if you, with that landscape, essentially what's happening is like regular people who are not very technically savvy could go out, buy these devices and install them. So what you started asking questions like, if the hardware ecosystem is all there, why is the smart home of our imagination not there? So I think we got together about 30 or 40 researchers in a room trying to understand the space, what's going on, and we learned a lot of things from that workshop, but also from visiting people who are living in automated homes or smart homes as they exist today. So the kinds of things we learned was like, yeah, these devices are easy to buy and install, but actually integrating them in your home is what's really hard. So you could get a device and then what?
Yeah.
And not only that, I think people found it hard to extend the technology. If you have some set of devices already, you don't have any idea around what to essentially buy that will be compatible with what you already have, or what software to bring on top of the devices. And also the other thing people found it hard was managing these devices. Like homes are multi-user domains, so it's very hard to do parental controls and things like that if you don't want your kids to play Xbox at night, and things like that were really, really hard to do. So what we realized through these expeditions and investigations was that essentially a whole software ecosystem was missing around on top of this hardware ecosystem that existed. And that's what we kind of set out to build. So initially we built this about 2 or 3 years ago. We built this infrastructure that we called Home OS.
Yeah.
And we call it Home OS because the vision there is just like your PC has an operating system, your home should have an operating system that makes it easy to essentially write applications and integrate new devices, just like Windows does today. You can write a driver, or a device maker can write a driver for Windows, and then that device becomes available to applications. We wanted to do the same thing for connected devices with the focus on the home. So we built this stuff, and the other reason we kind of built this stuff is there's a lot of research ideas we ourselves wanted to play with around how certain things should be done, like how automation should be done in the home in the way that is consistent with the wishes of the people, how security should be done in the home, and how energy management should be done in the home. So we were kind of like, you know, for us it was kind of like a playground. We had to build this to be able to study. So this was the precursor, so we could study these things. So after we built it, we found that, you know, we are not the only ones. So we kind of learned how to build it, but we were not the only ones who could use it. So 2 years ago, we started essentially academic licensing. So our research colleagues in academia and other industrial research labs could start playing with it. And then essentially, so they started playing with it and people built a lot of cool stuff. And then we kind of realized that, you know, to actually scale, so Home OS, we realized that Home OS solved one problem, which is how to connect applications and drivers together to each other easily. What we realized that if you want to do deployments that are bigger, there are other things that are needed as well. How do you actually manage these deployments, these research deployments? So if I have a study running in 20 homes, how do I know whether this study is functioning? How do I monitor it and things like that? So then we realized that it's very critical for the infrastructure here to actually be cloud enabled. So, and the cloud could actually then help you essentially monitor and manage deployments, update the apps and drivers and so forth. So that's kind of the second hurdle we were facing, and we went out and built, and then we started calling this Lab of Things. This is essentially the cloud part of Home OS. And the other thing we then realized was that it's not just about connecting apps and drivers or managing the scale, it's also a lot about diversity of installation. So if I'm studying, for instance, energy usage in a home, energy usage patterns are very different in Seattle it's a relatively mild city versus like take a city on the East Coast that gravitates a lot between super hot to super cold. So essentially, if you want to formulate your scientific hypothesis, you have to have geographic diversity in there. So what we also enable through Lab of Things is for scientists or academics to actually be able to share their deployments. So if I went out and recruited a dozen homes in Redmond, mm-hmm. and somebody else recruited, let's say, a dozen homes in New York, we should be able to run experiments in each other's house. So that's essentially what Lab of Things kind of enables. It enables people to easily build application scenarios they're interested in. It enables people to do scale of deployments and also diversity of deployments across a large number of homes. And that's kind of like the three steps or the three things we focus on in Lab of Things.
And you have a CodePlex page.
Oh, yeah.
Where can people find this?
Oh, it's on labofthings.codeplex.com. And all our source code is there. It's completely free. You can downloadable for non-commercial use and research and things like that. The fun thing, actually, through this licensing program has been like the kinds of cool things actually people have built that we did not imagine could be built. And that has been very, very satisfying because not only it has told us what flaws existed in our platform, but also what kind of cool things. I think things that the kinds of things I've been surprised by, for instance, like just a simple idea that some students had at University of Washington of integrating Kinect with home automation system. And it's one of the things, once you see it, you go like, why didn't I think of that?
Yeah.
A simple idea, you're sitting on a couch and you can point at the light bulb and the light kind of goes out. It's very, very cool. So for automation, other things that people have built is just energy modeling. Like, you know, your home energy consumption is being monitored by HomeOS, and you can build essentially high fidelity models of it. And essentially, what HomeOS or the app running on HomeOS runs learns is how much energy do you consume at Tuesdays on 2 p.m. Mm-hmm. And on some Tuesday at 2 p.m., if your energy usage is more than normal, it can send you alerts as to what's going on. And you may have left some appliance on, and it'll send you alerts, and you can fix that. A third category of things people have been building is around healthcare in the home. So in particular, I think a project comes to mind where in University of Maryland, Nilanjan Banerjee is the name of the person who's leading the project, to essentially make paraplegic patients control the environment through gestures. So they are playing with like really cool devices, some custom sensors, where people who are paraplegic can do just small gestures. And these gestures can be used to control the environment, be lights or doors and things like that. And it's kind of nice because these are the kinds of applications that we didn't have in mind, but people could go out and build.
Yeah.
And with this licensing program, that has been our goal all along, that people who want to study technology in the home, they shouldn't have to do a ground up, build up the entire stack of technology that's needed. They should be able to just start with this and focus on purely the logic and the mechanics of the scenario or the experiment they want to do versus worrying about how to connect devices, how to connect manage deployments, how to get scale and so forth.
There. So yeah. what are the types of things that you might connect to this this home OS and the Lab of Things, other than like, you know, to turn off lights and things? It would be like temperature of your house or cameras or anything like that?
Oh, totally. So in principle, you can connect anything. The driver model is very extensible. So if we don't support a device today, you can essentially write a driver, just like you can write a driver for Windows today. But today on CodePlex, as the code is available today, we can connect to things like cameras, motion sensors, light sensors, humidity, door window sensors, even locks to some extent.
Nice.
And we build scenarios across these things. But not only that, I think, an energy meter. Other people, like I was saying, have extended this to beyond, I think, for devices that we did not support, but other people wrote drivers for it. So things like there's a driver for Zigbee. It's not very mature right now, but people are working on it. There's a driver for a whole house energy meter that came out of University of Waterloo. There's a driver for Fitbit that some students at Indiana University wrote. And there's drivers for things like Synapse Wireless and things like that. And people are just, you know, the idea is that if you want to play with the device and we don't have a driver, it should be easy for you to kind of write your driver. And once you write it, you can contribute back to the community so that others can build on it. And that process essentially speeds up the entire, for the next person that comes along wants to play with the device, it becomes easier for them to do
nice.
That. Yeah.
Excellent. Well, thanks for joining us today. We're going to encourage you to go to Lab of Things on CodePlex. Mm-hmm. Check it out there, download it, and we'll end this with a demo from your building.
Yeah. Okay. Great. Thank you.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Hi. Hi, I'm AJ. I'm here to give you a demo of our Lab of Things platform. I encourage you to check out our code on our CodePlex site. So Lab of Things is mainly aimed at people like me who like to deploy field studies into 10, 12 homes of sensors, but it's good for do-it-yourselfers too. So I'm going to give you an example of the platform using a study I'm running right now. You can see in our management portal that I've got 8 homes in simple study 1. And what I put in each of those homes was a computer, a Windows computer we call the Home Hub. It's really running the platform. And and a Z-Wave device, we can talk to some sensors. This is a multi-sensor. It does motion, temperature, luminosity as well. And then a simple door window sensor. You put this on the back of your door and it fires every time the door is open. So we're looking at how often people leave the house and, in fact, how warm it is in their kitchen. It's just an example study. So what I want to show you is how we set up that technology in each of the homes. So on the Home Hub, the first thing you have to do just once is get the hub on the home wireless network. So we're going to go ahead here and join the home wireless network with our super secure password there. Don't try that at home, have a better one. All you need is a home ID. This password's only used if remote access is lost, and then a default email. You would use your own, of course. So now what's happening is the hub is talking to our cloud and configuring its home ID, and now it's ready to go. There's a remote access link and my home ID. So at this point, that was one-time setup. We're at the home dashboard where you see things. So in this study, we're going to add a couple of devices here, and then I'll show you a few more. And we have a bunch of different devices that I'll talk about at the end. So the first step is to click the Add Devices button. Add Devices goes out and looks on the network to see what devices it can find. In this case, it found the camera on my laptop. It turns out that Z-Wave devices are a little special. They talk to this dongle here, and that has to be put into a special pairing mode. So I'll click the Add Z-Wave button. I'll tell it's a door window sensor. You don't have to do this, but it's kind of nice. And then I'll click this pair button. When I do that, I click the little program button on the sensor. That adds it. So let me go ahead and give this a nice name for door one. I can give it a location, my home, or if I want to put it in a specific room, you just add it. And then what the platform says is, I have these applications that work with the door window sensor. What would you like? Would you like to give any of them permission? So I'm going to go ahead and click sensor here and also alerts. So when I click done, you can see on the main screen that it's added those two applications to my configuration. So if I go into alerts, this is just a very simple application that we whipped together. So everything in gray, the DIYer or the researcher running the study would write. And so when I click these together, an alert is triggered and an email sent, in this case to XXS, but in a real case to your email. So let's go ahead and add the second sensor. This is the multi-sensor. So again, the sequence of events is very similar. I go into Add Devices. This is a Z-Wave device. So again, I'm going to tell it what kind of device. Click that pairing button. And in this case, the pair button is inside, so I open it and click pair. Back at that final device setup page, I'll call this one my kitchen multi-sensor. I'll go ahead, I don't think kitchen's here, so I'll add the location for kitchen, putting it in my kitchen. And go ahead, in this case, I'll just add it to the sensor app. That's a logging app that just records the different values that are seen, so I can show you that in a second. Put this back together, and we're ready to go. So if I go into the sensor app, this is an app I use for my studies a lot. It just reads the data that's coming off these sensors and puts it in the cloud so a researcher can see it. So now I'm going to add a few other devices. So first I'm going to add this FOSCam. It's an IP-connected camera. So when I go and click Add Devices, what the platform does is it searches for other devices that it can find on my home wireless network to make it easy for me to install them. So it found the integrated camera on the Home Hub, and also the FOSCam and the Hue Bridge to talk to some Hue lights that I have. So I'll click on the FOSCam. This FOSCam is already on my home wireless network. If not, I'd be given the option to set that up. And so I go ahead and call this my living room camera. Put it in my living room. and a new application is available because the platform knows that now I'm going to have a camera so I can run the camera viewer application. Go ahead and click done. That brings us back to the dashboard, and now I have a new application, camera viewer. If I click into camera viewer, again, these are very simple, wave to it, hello, very simple applications that end users, researchers, DIYers write to play and to connect the different devices in the home in the way they want. We've provided sample applications like camera viewer and alerts and the sensor logger. So let me go back to the dashboard. I have one more thing I want to show you, which is the store. And again, this is just to get across that the platform is trying to make it really easy for you to understand what you could add to your home. So it'll tell you here that you have things installed and that there's a few more applications that you could install, but it would require additional devices. So in this case, if I wanted to control my lights, I need to install a switch. So I've been showing you how Lab of Things works with off-the-shelf devices, ones that we just purchased. But in case you want to make your own sensors and actuators, which we do, we've connected Lab of Things to the Microsoft.net Gadgeteer platform. So this is a window camera we've been playing with, and this is the innards. So you can see that Microsoft.net Gadgeteer is just a hardware prototyping platform where you can plug and play lots of different things together to make your own devices. Thanks for watching. We hope you go to our CodePlex site and give Lab of Things a try. We think it's a great platform to enable experimentation by researchers and do-it-yourselfers with connected devices in the home. Thank you.